everybody. I'm Errol Meidinger. I'm here to welcome you as Vice Dean for Research on behalf of Dean Mikhail Mutua, who considers this a very important event but can't be here himself. But we really are pleased that Senator Grisanti has agreed to come and speak with the Buffalo environmental law community. Before I introduce him, I want to introduce a couple of other people in the crowd, particularly Professor Kim Deanna Connolly, who is the director of the Environmental Law Concentration, or program, as it now is, also the director of clinical legal education and soon to be Vice Dean for Legal Skills. And I would also like to introduce the heads of the Buffalo Environmental Law Society, Catherine Curry, who is the current president, and Adam Hayes, who will be the incoming president, and who was the primary organizer of this event. And we owe them a debt of gratitude. Adam will be speaking with you more after Senator Grisanti's presentation. This evening, the law school is very pleased to welcome a very distinguished speaker, professor, or rather senator, much more distinguished than professor.
I was promoted. I like that.
Mark Grisanti, who was Senator Grisanti, was born and raised in Buffalo, earned his bachelor's degree at Canisius, went on to get his law degree at the Thomas Cooley School of Law, then moved back to Buffalo to work in his family's law practice on the Lower West Side, where he showed a particular commitment to advancing the interests of the less fortunate. He's now the New York State Senator from the 60th District, which includes parts of Tonawanda, Kenmore, Niagara Falls, downtown Buffalo, and Grand Island. It includes Love Canal, so there's long experience with big environmental issues in the 60th District. He serves as chairperson of the Environmental Conservation Committee in the Senate, and from the beginning of his Senate career, he has made a mark as an advocate for the environment. As chairman of the Senate of the Environmental Conservation Committee, he's advanced a number of reforms relevant to the environment. I'll mention only a couple, including sponsoring New York's water withdrawal legislation to ensure compliance with the Great Lakes Compact, and also strongly advocating for enhancing the state environmental protection fund. Recently, the Audubon Society recognized Senator Grisanti by awarding him this year's William Hoyt Environmental Excellence Award for supporting issues linked to birds, wildlife, and their habitats. Senator Grisanti will speak for approximately 30 minutes. He'll then take questions for approximately another 30 minutes from members of the UB Law School community, the students, faculty, and staff at UB Law School. Adam Hayes and I will help moderate that conversation. So without any further delay, Senator Grisanti, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning and happy belated Earth Day. Earth Day was yesterday, as you may know. I was on your campus probably about, maybe about 6 hours ago for the UB Strand for the solar panels that have recently been put up here. Very exciting how it's going to power over 700 units for students here in this area. Unfortunately, we had to do it inside instead of outside because basically Mother Nature was not cooperating with us. But just take a few moments. I'm here with Joel Ferraletto, who's a UB alum, also an attorney. I'm here with Doug Carell, who's my chief of staff, also an attorney. I'm also here with my wife, Marie, who's a paralegal. So we have very legal-orientated individuals that are here, not only amongst yourselves, but also on my staff as well. Transition from being in the private sector as an attorney to the New York State Senate was quite enlightening. And, I'm not ashamed to pat myself on the back that I did hit the ground running. And in all honesty, nobody really wanted to take the chair of the Senate NCON Committee. Because of some of the controversial issues that were around last year and that were coming up this year. And we did some significant things last year, and there's going to be some significant things this year on certain issues, and I'll bring those up in a moment. But As was stated, for the EPF fund, for those of you who don't know, it's the Environmental Protection Fund, that for the last 2 years, we've kept at $134 million, and this particular fund is used for numerous environmental issues that are across New York State. In particular, you can earmark things, you know, so to speak, in our district in Western New York for Olmsted Parks, Darrow Martin House, River Keepers, Niagara River Greenway Commission, organizations such as that, and that's something that I focus on and I make sure of. Prior to me becoming the New York State Senate, those particular items and those that I mentioned for Western New York never really saw a dime because basically all the money was going downstate. So Western New York, and I don't like to make it an upstate downstate thing, but in certain aspects it is, but basically downstate doesn't think we exist here in Western New York and they think we're up as far. So I'm proud to have a very loud voice not only in the Senate on social issues, on economic issues, but also on environmental issues as well. Now, also last year, my wife and I, we actually were in New York City last October. We actually met with Senator Espiot, and we talked about what's called the sewage right-to-know legislation. And basically, there was a sewage treatment plant that was on the Harlem and Hudson Rivers that had a fire. And without telling the public, they discharged millions and millions of gallons of raw sewage into the waterways without telling the people that were swimming and without telling the voters when they were in these lakes when it was about 90 degrees outside. So you can imagine the lovely smell swimming at these beaches and not having any sort of knowledge as to what was going on. And what was interesting that we found, myself and the senator, by having a hearing in Manhattan, was that one side, the EPA for New York State, and or for New York City, and the state had no idea what the other one was doing. And quite simply, what we found out was that when somebody was entering, let's say, the state parks or entering a beachway and you had to pay your admission fee because nothing's really free in New York State, they wouldn't tell the family that was there with their young ones or maybe by themselves or a young couple or somebody just trying to enjoy the beach that there was a sewage spill. And the reason why they didn't tell is because they didn't know themselves. But yet they have computer access that are right in those little huts when they collect the funds. They didn't tell any of the marinas that are in the area that you know, basically by email, which does exist, and by way of marine band radio. At this hearing, we found out that those two entities alone, just by the park system checkpoint and the marinas, could have alerted tens of thousands of people to stay out of the water. As a matter of fact, they had races going on, both swimming races and canoe races. So, and after the hearing and some of the people were there, they were telling us how lovely it was to paddle and to swim in some of that sewage once they hit that debris field, so to speak, in those waters. So this particular piece of legislation will not only help prevent that in the future, but as you may know, for those of you from the Western New York area, that happens quite frequently when you have the beaches in Hamburg, when we have some of the sewage treatment plants, and it's, you know, if it was nice out today, it probably happened this weekend where they would say we have to close the beaches because we have sewage overflow. So that is something that that we are addressing right now. Going back to the EPF, I sponsored what's called the unclaimed deposits on the bottle bills. And what that is basically not everybody returns their 5 cents or nickels on their deposits, but yet the people pay those deposits when you purchase that particular product. You know what I'm talking about, correct? A lot of people don't redeem them, and they go into what's dubbed as unclaimed deposits. And we estimate that figure to be roughly $200 million. And what we've tried to do is to have the EPF increased by starting out a small, either a percentage or a monetary amount of funding to go over a 5-year period to increase the EPF funding. Now, the problem with it is, and speaking with the governor's office as early as last week, you have to make up for that loss of revenue because that unclaimed deposit is now what's called in the general fund of monies that are used for other projects. I'm trying to get it earmarked as well as other areas of money earmarked for specific purposes so nobody has to worry about programs being cut. In this instance, I'm trying to get the money earmarked to the EPF to increase it. Now, the EPF, the governor has said, you know, we cannot do it this year because we don't know what we're going to come up with. Let's say if you increase it by $20 million, where are we going to come up with $20 million in next year's budget? We already just got rid of a $10 billion deficit and a $3 billion deficit for this year without raising taxes and fees. We need to figure out, you know, where we can get that other money from and we'll work on that next year. But we are going to try to pass some fraud legislation because there is fraud in this system as well as many other systems in New York State, unfortunately, that totals about $10 to $14 million that we think that the governor will be behind to increase that into the EPF fund, which is still a significant amount of money that will help increase that in the future. Today, as you know, as I mentioned before, with the solar strand, which is very important, I'm also the co-sponsor of the solar jobs bill, and it's offered by Senator Maziarz. And this bill, in our estimation, would create roughly 22,000 solar jobs in the state and would increase the amount of solar to the scale of 5,000 megawatts. Now, it's unfortunate because at the present time, New York State is severely lagging in solar development. As a matter of fact, New York has such an untapped potential of solar electrical power that it could exceed that of Germany, which is actually the leader on solar electric. And New York State has that capability. Unfortunately, we are not at that point yet, but with some of the new installations and some of the things that you saw that, and you gotta be proud of this, that happened right here on your own campus, in using over 40 local construction contractors, local groups for that project. That's 40 businesses that are locally in this area that actually helped out in that project and was able to sustain jobs for that period of time. It's very important. They did a great job with regards to that. And if we have more projects like that, we can continue. But at present time, New York State is only producing about 100 megawatts. That's just 100 megawatts of solar power, where you have other states like Maryland at 1,500, New Jersey at 5,000, other states, Massachusetts is even, you know, smaller than us, but yet producing over 400 megawatts. Ohio at 750 and Pennsylvania at 1,500. And to me, New York, you know, we could be a leader in promoting this electricity and a leader of renewable sources. And, you know, we're just starting to hit the ground with regards to that particular avenue. And that's too bad, but I'm glad to see we're on the right direction and we need to get the solar jobs bill passed. Again, last year we did some legislation with regards to mercury. This year I'm also looking to build on the mercury protection legislation. I got chaptered last year. I'm sponsoring another bill to move forward, and that has to do with limiting the amount of mercury allowed in light bulbs. A lot of people don't realize that that's the case, but it really is. And also the mercury thermostats recycling bill. We do not do enough with regards to mercury thermostats. It is something that is still a problem. It aims to get thousands of thermostats off the walls and out of our landfills and dispose them properly. And I'm working with Honeywell and a bunch of other groups in order to get that done. As a matter of fact, Honeywell, they signed some sort of legislation that I think they were kind of blindsided on in Illinois, so we're trying to mirror image that piece of legislation, and it's something that we're working on right now in the NCON committee. The children's protection ban is another one. Last year, we look at a particular product where you had the flammable products in clothing on children that was banned. Unfortunately, that same product was not banned from children's products, from their bedding, from the foam and the insulation that is in the car seats, in their cribs, in their bedding. So I'm still working on those parameters on that bill to not use these toxic chemicals to affect children. So there are so many good bills banning these individual chemicals and other TRIS bills, and I'm hoping to get that as a major piece of legislation through this year. Other areas, you know, as you know, it's not just about legislation as a whole. You know, myself and my family and my staff, and hopefully you did as well, we took part in a lot of Green Earth Day activities that took place over this weekend, in particular with Reuse of Buffalo, which recycles and reuses products that they take out of houses that are being demolished. Worked with river keepers and the Skajakwood and the 190 along Delaware Park and cleaning up the riverbeds. They were working also down at Ohio Street at the boat docks down there. Also, the Elmwood Village Association had many things going on. And really, it was a sense of community and a sense of pride getting together. Whether, well, you know what, now what we planted probably died. So we'll probably have to talk to next weekend, unfortunately, because we'll have to bug Home Depot again because they actually donated a lot of the products. But you know, it was nice to see, especially for the river keepers, there was probably about 200 people out volunteering. Reuse Buffalo, there was probably about 75. but not only helping inside the warehouses do a lot of things to organize that particular facility, but also then going out in the community and planting flowers and shrubs and cleaning up some of the vacant lots. And, you know, shouldn't be surprising, but when I was stopped by the Riverkeepers, they actually had the little canisters for hazardous materials, and I couldn't believe that one person alone followed over 27 needles around Delaware Park. I mean, 27 needles, and you know, it's unbelievable. But I was thinking to myself, as we walk, you know, our dogs around there sometimes, or, you know, you could have your kids playing. You know, people don't stay on the path, and they run out into the fields and all that, and God forbid they get stuck with one of those needles. So it's something that, you know, everybody can take a part in and making sure that that happens. So Earth Day was very important. The for those of you that don't know, when Earth Day was actually first started in 1970, that was the year. For those that are old enough, they'll know this. For the younger ones, you won't. Jimi Hendrix had passed away. Everybody know Jimi Hendrix? Okay, good. The last Beatles album came out, and that wonderful song by Simon and Garfunkel, "Bridge Over Troubled Waters," came out. And I didn't know any of this stuff up to a couple years ago, because I thought Earth Day was around a lot longer than 1970. But unfortunately, in the U.S., that's where it started. And basically, with the anti-war protest that was going on for the Vietnam War, people started turning their energy and their consciousness and channeling energy into the Earth and the environment concerns front and center, rather than the war itself going on. And at that time, that's when the Environmental Protection Agency was first born. The Clean Act, Clean Air, and Endangered Species Act was first instituted. And you really had Republicans, Democrats, city slickers, farmers, tycoons, more working together to make sure that Earth Day happened. And then in 1990, that's when Earth Day really went global, with over 200 million people taking effect in over 141 countries. And as you know, in the millennium, when everybody thought the Earth was going to crash and come, you know, whatever, it was in a, I remember that, it was a song, you know, Susie at 2000, we're all going to die. But that didn't happen. Global warming, the focusing on energy and everything else took place. And in 2012, just yesterday, it's estimated that 1 billion people took part around the globe with participation in Earth Day 2012, and it helped mobilize the Earth. And with, you know, with things like that, and together we stand in united for the sustainable future, and we called upon our government, our individuals, and our organizations to do that. Another thing that we took part of today was, you know, it's right down the street on County Line Road, and that's Natale Builders. And has anybody actually went into one of these greenhouses? Anybody? You know, I invite you to really check this out. Just, you know, French Road, Crossover Transit, County Road, Natale Builders, they have some things that are going on there with regards to green energy and green buildings. And what they actually did, it's quite remarkable. Every single product that is in this house is recyclable material from the floors. They were painting ceilings and doors, and you don't smell the paint, because the paint and the chemicals that they have don't exist in these products. As a matter of fact, this particular house, you will not have a gas bill or an electric bill in this house. Could you imagine that? Owning a house without a gas bill, electric bill. And they use thermal energy where they go down into the ground. And it's interesting what they were telling me, that 8 feet down in the ground, the earth sustains a temperature of 55 degrees. And the water that's down there, they're able to tap into that. So rather than if you're at your house with your thermostat and it's 0 degrees outside, you have to get that furnace cranked to take that air from outside and go up to 70 degrees. In this case, that particular water that is brought into this hydrothermal heating unit already starts out at 55 degrees. So you only have to raise another 15 degrees to get to that point. So it's 80% efficient. And it's also in conjunction with your hot water tank, so you basically have free hot water. So that is something that was remarkable to me. All the Corian tile, they call it, that was on the countertops, is all recycled tile. All of the floors that they had in there was recyclable building materials from all different products that has a very strong rating for not only sound but environmental friendly. You don't need carbon monoxide detectors because there's no carbon monoxide in the house. The subdivision itself is run by wind power that generates the electricity for the streetlights, for the lights in front of your house, and for the lighting in the gazebo area that they have in this complex. So it's quite unique. It's something else that you may find interesting if you have a dual major in archaeology. They actually have on just behind this house called dinosaur grass. And dinosaur grass, believe it or not, I mean, this is something I learned today, so you learn something new every day I'm going to share with you. This dinosaur grass is millions of years old. Millions of years old. And only exists in 7 locations in the entire state, and they found it. It was in existence in the subdivision lot that they have. And trust me, they were going to get a licking from, I'm sure, environmental groups and from other groups if they were messing with this grass. But they didn't do that, so that was good. And it's just wonderful. And there's projects like this that are going to spur up. So I think now is the time. To move forward on the environment with regards to solar energy, but with regards to wind, our renewable energies as much as possible. So it's something that we take very strongly. Now, as I talked about before, with regards to the solar bill, this legislation, as I said, is going to help us move past, hopefully, where we should be, and maybe actually compete with countries like Germany and moving forward with regards to that. Now, one of the big issues that is up right now in NCON, besides some of the chemical bills and other pieces of legislation, and yes, there are instances where we make sure we take care of our four-legged friends and a few other things. As a matter of fact, they have a piece of legislation coming out on those that abuse animals, and I'm sure everybody here loves animals, right? Raise your hands, okay, good. And we're taking care of that. But another piece of legislation that is coming out has to do with hydrofracking. I'm sure you've all heard about hydrofracking and what that entails. Vertical fracking is a process that has been going on in this state for decades and decades. Hydraulic fracturing is a process that goes deeper into the earth. There's a lot more fracturing. There's a lot of water that's used. There's chemicals that are mixed with this water along with sand to break up this Marcellus shale that is deep within the earth's core to release its natural gas. And actually, there are some people that say that they want to try this drilling technique with liquid petroleum. What is actually kind of scary, and that's something that it's been done in Texas, but it's not something that has been looked at here, and it's something that we're going to make sure that before that is ever tried, that we will make sure that that's taken care of, because liquid petroleum in the earth, I can just imagine if somebody was smoking or something along those lines, you would have these explosions underground. But with regards to hydrofracking, the main goal is basically to make sure that the environment is safe, that our drinking water is safe, and that the communities are safe. Right now, there is a regulatory moratorium. What I mean by that is there was a moratorium that expired in December of last year. The regulatory moratorium that's in place right now basically means that there are no permits being issued because there is still a study being done. The supplemental SGIS report is being done. And throughout, I would say, the last year, there was about 40,000 or 50,000 comments that were taken from hearings that were held across the state. I myself took part in some of those hearings, actually holding some of the hearings, actually going to some of the hearings and listening, and also in my district office in Buffalo and in Albany, listening to those that have concerns on both sides with regard to this issue. A lot of the concerns that I had, there are people that say, we should have a moratorium on hydrofracking. Some people saying we should drill automatically. Well, at the present time, there is no permits being issued. There is no drilling taking place with hydraulic fracturing. So rather than, you got to let the scientists do the work. I mean, as I said, I'm an attorney. I look at the legal end of these things and chair of the NCON committee. And, we'll see where the DEC is going to come out after their SGIS report. But what I did do is I listened to some of those comments and some of those concerns. Some of those concerns, I think, I put forth in some legislation that it's 5 bills that are coming out. And it has to do with regards to putting the public on notice. It has to do with our public treatment facility plants, and it has to do with tracking. So let me tell you exactly what some of these things are. First of all, when this fluid comes back up, because a lot of it does come back up and some of it stays deep in the earth, there's no place that I feel in New York State that can treat what I term as flowback water. So the these particular bills that I have, it prohibits public-owned treatment facility plants from accepting this wastewater associated with the exploration of high-volume hydraulic fracturing. So, in my estimation as well, the hydrocarbons that are in this fluid actually destroy the microorganisms that are in these publicly-owned treatment facility plants. They would destroy the treatment facility plant's ability to even treat regular processes as it does now. So it's something to where, you know, without having further studies with regards to that, I don't think it's something that can be done. As a matter of fact, the two industrial sites in the state, which are in Niagara Falls, and which are in the city of Tonawanda, you know, they have a little bit of better equipment to handle something like this, but I still included that in this ban, and I'll tell you why. Because I've talked with the Niagara Falls Treatment Board, and I just don't think that they have at this time the proper technique in place in order to treat this particular flowback water, and then they dump it in the gorge down, and it goes into Lake Ontario. So it's not something that that we wanted to see. And there are standards that we put in place in this bill that if they wanted to move forward on it, they can. You know, it's not a ban, sort of speaking. It's sort of basically saying you're not going to be able to do it. Prove it to us that you can do it. Now, there are private treatment facility plants that are being built in Pennsylvania, because Pennsylvania basically took off with the hydro fracking revolution early on, and they did so in a very poor manner. They did so without regulation, and they did so with, in my regard, no regard for the community whatsoever. And I can tell you that places like Dimmock, Pennsylvania, and other places where, and I'm sure you may have seen that movie Gasland, where things were done there, our regulations are such right now in New York State that we would not even be able to drill in places like Dimmock and a couple other places. So, you know, I feel that New York State is moving in the right direction by having these regulations, but, you know, you have to go through this comment period first. And myself having these hearings and hearing these issues with regards to this flowback water, that is something that I felt why we needed something with regards to these public treatment facility plants, because it was not brought up in the SGIS report, and it may be brought up in some of those comments, but I figured since I heard it and I chair the ENCON committee, I might as well bring it up and see what we can do. We also prohibit the use of the wastewater from road and land spreading. And I don't know if you basically know what that means, but there's a lot of salt content with regards to this flowback water. And what they do is they use it in spraying for dust control, and they also put it on the roads to save municipalities money with regards to ice in the wintertime. So that would be prohibited under high-volume hydraulic fracturing. We also create an oil and gas waste tracking program that is stronger than the tracking program that is proposed under the draft SGIS report. Now, I've heard some people say, well, it's not really that strong because you don't have like that system where you can tell where these trucks are going and monitor them through satellite. Well, you know, it's really not necessary, because what this particular process is, and the reason why it's strengthened, is that every leg of that journey, from the time that water is picked up, if this process were to go forward until its end result, there's a manifest that has to be followed, which is going to prevent basically the dumping, the illegal dumping of this water. And, you know, the thing is that people are saying, well, you should have tracking systems, you know, for the trucks. They do it for plows, they do it for other things. But, you know, that's something that I wouldn't say would not happen in the future. But it's something that right now, if you're going to, you know, if you're treating it as medical waste, I think you need to track it as if it was hazardous waste. So we use that hazardous tracking program that is in place now, and we use that in order to track this particular flowback water, as I said, if this process goes forward. I also think we need to strengthen notification requirements with regards to discharges. And what I mean is quite simply is this. And I had to amend the bill a little bit because I included everything so broadly that if a clean water truck, a regular H2O truck, was leaking, they would actually have to report that. And I didn't think that there was something that was too smart. So basically what it means and what they have in the SGIS report by the DEC is that if there is a leak, they had a time period of 24 hours that they could report that particular leak on one of these trucks. or other things that happen, if there's a spill or if there's something that happens at a capping or a site or something along those lines. You know, 24 hours to me seemed a little bit too long. We actually have in place already for oil and petroleum spills a two-hour window. So we figured that if that program is already in place, then you should use a two-hour rule as well. And then the last part of the bill that we did is we created a geographic information system to provide information to the public. And this was something that the Environmental Protection Agency actually wanted us to do concerning gas and oil production. Basically, what it would do is if this process went forward, where exactly are these wells? How many well heads are on a particular well platform? What stage are they in drilling? You know, how many trucks? It's basically a system that that would also be a notification for the public itself. Now, there was a couple other concerns that were brought up after these bills came out. And one of them had to do with, and it actually was brought up on the Senate floor during the budget process. And it had to do with, you know, have you done any, you know, health and welfare studies with regards to the communities? And I know that the Department of Health here in New York State, as well as the DEC, and actually in the Senate, we have a council that has both Senate Republicans, Democrats and Republicans that are on this council that are looking also at some of these processes that are going on if this process goes forward, these health impact studies. And, you know, I'm not saying that it's not going to be in the final SJS report, but we are looking at other states that have had health impact studies done. Now, granted, the topography and the geographs and everything of the other states are a little bit different than New York State, but it's a starting point because, to be quite honest with you, it's very hard to study something in the state if you're not doing it in this state. And if you're not doing high volume hydrofracking in this state, how do you do a health impact study? So you look at the health impact studies that are done in Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Texas, and you look to see what some of those concerns are. Now we know what a lot of the concerns are. A lot of concerns are the water, a lot of the concerns are going forward. But you know, there's something you gotta remember here is that the process right now is not happening. The vertical hydrofracking is happening. There was nothing in the budget to move this process forward. There are no, what I'd like to call, and it's a concern of mine, the DEC itself has been gutted throughout the years of 2008, 2009, and 2010, prior to me coming in the Senate. Gutted, you know, from their police to their people that they have to patrol certain areas to people that issue permits, they're gutted. So you would have to, in my opinion, start off first by, in a budget process, if this was going to move forward, by earmarking funds. And we talked about earmarking earlier in the bottle bill. You would have to find funding and earmark it, whether it's going to be from permits, the fees on permits, to the DEC, to hire people, to hire individuals who are either qualified or who need to be trained in order to monitor if this process were to go forward. And I'm talking about not a person that, you know, stops by every, you know, once a month. I mean, some of these wells could be fracked very quickly, people could be in and out very quickly, and they could be refracked later on. But what I'm saying is you need somebody that is trained in the permit process, the inspection process, to make sure that if this process does go forward, that we don't have any problems. And to me, that's the first thing that needs to be done. Trust me, the oil and gas companies have a significant amount of monies where those fees can be paid to make sure that happens if this process goes forward. So it's something that's going to be very interesting. I don't particularly see the SGIS report being completed for another 6 to 8 months. I know it's a long process, but you know what? It doesn't matter because the process that is going forward. I mean, you're talking about 40 to 50,000 comments from various individuals, from groups, from concerned citizens of the great state of New York that are concerned about this process. And it's a tough issue. I mean, it's a tough issue in the sense of, you know, going forward or not going forward. And at the present time, I'm going to let these reports, you know, see where they play out, see where they go. But in the meantime, do some legislation that I felt should be in there. And then look at it again once the final report comes out and see exactly where we stand. I can tell you that I know at first report the amount of jobs that they said that, you know, could be created to me were a little bit exaggerated. I have looked at studies that have toned that down, and I believe that those figures are correct. And I don't believe that if New York State was to start off with this process of hydrofracking, that they would start off at a monumental scale, only because I don't think the DEC, as I said, can handle it with the type of people that they have at their staffing levels. But starting off slow, there is some economic growth. There are some jobs there that are well needed in the southern tier. I mean, it's, you know, you can see that the job growth and the jobs were created, and basically the spark that it gave to Pennsylvania and other areas across the United States. But you also take a look at what is happening now with the price of gas itself being so low that they're actually scaling back on some drilling that is being done in Pennsylvania because the amount is so low. So it's an interesting discussion that is going to continue on for the rest of the year. And I have friends that I talk to, and some may say I'm an enemy, but I'm really not. I mean, basically, I look at issues on both sides, and I think I come to a sound conclusion, hopefully. But like I said, when you have controversial events such like that, not everybody's going to be happy with decisions. So there's a lot more I could talk about, but I know that I only had a half an hour to really bring up to speed on a lot of things. I could just tell you briefly how things happen in the state Senate. There are numerous bills that are constantly brought to the attention of the committee that I chair. And what happens is that those particular bills, you know, what I do with a particular bill, whether it's environmental or something else, is I actually look to see what kind of sponsorship I have, not only in my own house with the Senate Republicans, but also my colleagues in a bipartisan fashion on the Democratic side. And I look to see if I actually have a co-sponsor in the Assembly. Because I'm sure you guys have heard, you know, some people come out with these crazy bills and they're just done for fluff and they're just done for to get something, their name in the paper. And I don't do that. I actually bring out pieces of legislation because I want them to pass. I want them to move forward. And if you don't have somebody on the Assembly side, it's called a one house bill, is basically what it is. It's not going to go anywhere. So in the Senate, we basically, you know, when we take a look and we try to review some of these bills that are coming through the committee, first thing we do is we make sure that there are sponsorships in both the Assembly and the Senate, and that strong sponsorships to get out on the Senate floor. And from there, if it's going to be a financial impact to the state, if it passes out through my committee, it'll go to the Finance Committee, or if it's something dealing with certain rules or regulations, it'll have to eventually go to the Rules Committee. So there are probably about 15 bills, 20 bills that come out of the committee. I'm sure in these next couple of months, there's going to be a lot more bills that come out. Actually, it's only going to be about another month because committees have to close early. It'll only be about another month. But to give you an idea, last year I co-sponsored 108 pieces of legislation my freshman year. 46 of those legislation passed both houses, in the Senate, 46. 23, and out of those, you know, out of the 108, you had support on both sides. It's just that, you know, somebody didn't want to move them, somebody didn't want to push them. Out of the 46, you had strong support. 23 out of the 46, so 23 out of 108, not bad, you know, a little less than 25%, passed both houses, and the governor signed all 23 into law. And I'm proud of that fact, because these were not bills that were renaming street signs or throughway entrances. These were serious, serious environmental bills. Touched on one of them regarding the water withdrawal that came in a compliance with the Federal Clean Water Act. But there's other bills that protected not only, and that's why the Audubon was there, regarding birds and hunting and fishing. But there was TRIS bills dealing with chemicals. And there was a lot of other pieces of legislation out of those 23. And I'm hoping to surpass that mark. But it's actually the most that has ever passed as a freshman senator, somebody said, in the history of the Senate. So to come from Western New York, I take that very proudly. And I say, damn right, because I'm from Western New York. And I've got many voices over there. So, you know, I'm proud to push that forward this year. One of the most interesting ones that I had was the Bear Gallbladder Bill. You guys know what that is?
No.
Believe it or not, there are poachers that will go into our forests in the Adirondacks, and they would kill our Asian black bears, and they would gut them and take their bile and their gallbladders, and they would get back into Canada and send them over to China and Japan and sell them overseas at $15,000 a gallbladder. So there were people, there were hikers, they were finding these bears, basically gutted and killed very quickly, I'm sure it was painful for the bear, but I mean, it was very quickly that they were in and out, and at some point, some of these people came on the scene so fast that some of the bears were actually still alive, in a sense, you know, or very warm, to say the least. So we made that an issue that is a serious violation of your caught poaching. And we're doing the same thing because it's happening along the East Coast. And it's something we're looking into now, and they're doing it with sharks, where they're cutting the fins off of sharks, and the sharks are basically just dying, and they're washing up on the shores of the East Coast, and they're selling the fins overseas as edibles or in soups or in other products. And again, it's killing our wildlife. And again, the Animal Abuse Registry bill that I'm going to announce tomorrow basically makes a person who is convicted of animal abuse in New York State has to register. They have to pay the registration fee. They have to pay to keep that particular website or that particular notification process going to make sure that individual doesn't go ahead and try to purchase another animal while he's still on that register list, because believe it or not, a lot of these individuals specifically will go to the SPCA or to a specific, mostly to the SPCA or other places. They don't pay for it. They don't want to pay much for it. And they get these animals or these cats or what have you, and they use them in dog fighting and other things. So it's, or now you're hearing that they're actually stealing them right off the street. So it's something that's a concern of ours in the animal abuse. So, you know, we'll move forward from there. And there's probably going to be an interesting trial coming up, I think in May, regarding that young woman and her family that own all those horses. And that trial is going to be coming up on that sort of animal abuse. So, a lot of things going on in the Senate, and there's a lot more I can tell you, but with that said, I will open up the floor for some questions.
Thank you, Senator Grisanti.
If anyone has any questions, you know, some of you aren't just here for environmental law, so if you wanted to open up to anything that the Senate's dealing with or that Senator Grisanti has dealt with, please feel free to ask anything. So. Anyone
want to
ask the first question?
You guys are just here for the wine, correct?
Yes.
is that why? Okay.
Senator Grisanti, thank you for your leadership and your vote on marriage equality. I'm concerned about the air quality in Buffalo and Western New York. The Art Voice publication recently reported on a study that demonstrated an extremely high, higher than normal rate of incidence of childhood asthma in and around the area directly east of the Peace Bridge area,
okay,
on the west side of Buffalo. And for me, this is more than an academic interest. When my wife and I moved to Buffalo, we brought our 9-month-old baby with us. She turned 2 recently and was diagnosed with childhood asthma. So can you share some of your thoughts on air quality issues?
Absolutely. You know, especially, you know, digressing for a minute, there was the fire that happened in the Black Rock Riverside area where the air quality has been measured by the DEC, and we're talking about having that continue, and I actually wrote a letter asking that continue around the Peace Bridge area, near the Huntley coal plant that's over in Tonawanda. But specifically, I have seen the plans for the remediation project that they want to do with regards to the Peace Bridge Plaza. And I'll fill you guys in on what I've seen. And nothing's set in stone, so what I'm telling you right now is basically what I've seen with regards to these plans that they want to put forward. You guys have gone into Canada and have come back, right? As you can see on the Canadian side, it's wide open as far as the amount of inspectors and people that take your money from the tolls. That's one of the reasons why they started doing tolls on the other side, is because of the congestion that was happening on the American side, so they try to do a straight run. But you know that there's probably about 25 inspection stations that are on the Canadian side. When you come over into the Buffalo side from Canada, you see basically, 9? And 3 or 4 of those are for trucks. Now, with the trucks itself, there are only 2 inspection stations for the trucks that are right there, 2 of them. So what you have, and what a concern has been, is you have all these trucks that are idling in that particular area, the cars that are idling, and especially, you know, with the emissions and everything else that are going on, where all that emission is constantly, 24/7, just going out into the atmosphere, and that's a concern for many of your residents that are in the lower west side of Buffalo. The other concern is coming over. You have red lights that stop you right in front of right in front of Fun Park. There are red lights that are there, and you have people that are coming off of the thruway that have to come around, and there's always truck traffic there, where there's red lights that are basically controlling the direction of trucks and the vehicles. And again, in that area, you have idling. So not only do you have idling coming in, you have idling trying to get over. What the plan plans on doing, basically, is expanding the toll plaza area. And the Peace Bridge Authority, which is the owner of just about every single parcel that is on that side of Busty, they own the parcels. I think there's one house that they do not own, and they are looking at trying to acquire this one particular property. There's a nursing home that's down there that has been vacant for over a decade, well, close to two decades, that is full of drugs, prostitution, you know, a lot of things are going on there. They own all that area. They don't patrol it as well as they should, but they own it all. What they plan on doing is leveling that area and having a green buffer zone with the residents of the areas and properties that they're not going to interfere with. They're going to remove the red lights. They're not going to touch Front Park. They're going to remove the red lights and the red lights that are coming off the thruway. And what they're going to do is they're going to widen the lanes to get onto the bridge, and they're going to make it so it's a straight shot. So in other words, you don't have the idling that's happening coming over the bridge. And with today's standards from the federal government, some of the standards that we've done in the state, the emissions now that are being let go by some of these trucks have actually improved dramatically over the years, and they're improving to this day because you have certain times of requirements to go ahead and upgrade some of your equipment. But they're going to expand also the takers coming over the bridge, and they're going to expand the truck inspection stations to, I think, six, and also expand how many lanes you have for cars coming over to try to get people out of the way in a hurry. And I think if you could picture when you go into Canada, the way it's buffered and the way it's done is it's kind of like in a half moon, and it's buffered, you know, on all sides, and it's something they're trying to replicate on the American side. And there's funding that's there. Now, unfortunately, and it's something that I think would have been beneficial, is if they had another bridge. But the federal government dropped that plan. It's too costly at this point. It's a shame because we've been talking about it for years, and we always seem to get shortchanged, just like our lovely waterfront. But now that is coming into fruition, where that's starting to move forward. So your concern is definitely justified. I have seen the test results. The test results are kind of, they're a little bit older, but nonetheless, doesn't mean that they're less important, because apparently there was a problem there in the past, and there continues to be a problem, and there's other areas and hot spots, in the Lower West Side to deal with high blood pressure and deal with MS and a lot of other problems, and people are trying to find the root cause. But moving forward, I think that would help alleviate some of the emissions and some of the congestion and some of the problem that some of those residents are concerned with that are lying in that area. So hopefully it'll move in the right direction.
On your website, it lists that you're a proponent of charter schools, and the studies on that are equally as dubious and back and forth as the studies on hydrofracking. I was hoping you could explain the conflict there of how you can come out for something like charter schools and yet where the test results are equally as iffy as the hydrofracking. You know, still seem skeptical of that.
Well, I don't equate charter schools with hydrofracking, so
I
can answer with regard to charter schools is that the charter schools that I have seen and that I've seen the test results from have a very high graduation rate, way more so than the city of Buffalo, and it doesn't cost $25,000 per child like the Buffalo City Schools do that have a graduation rate of 23%. So what I'm looking at is the fact that we now have approximately 15, and it could be as high as 20 at the end of the school year this year, they're called PLA schools, persistently low achieving schools, that are on the federal and state register of schools that may have to close, which is 25% of our schools in Buffalo that have a graduation rate, especially among African Americans and Hispanics, at a rate that is disgusting, at 23%. Even lower, with a graduation rate overall, including Caucasians, of still at 47%, and you're spending $25,000 a student. Now, I know there's many variables there. There's the fact that children aren't actually going to school. So if they're not going to school, they're not going to learn, they're not going to graduate. So that has a huge impact. Children aren't interested once they're in school. so that's why they're not going, or they're not graduating. Or you have teachers that are basically kind of just pushing people along, giving little Johnny or little Sue a C or a D when they definitely can't read, and pushing them from grade to grade, so by the time they get out of grammar school, they basically, they probably read at a sixth grade level. So it's something that's a concern, and what I'm actually a proponent of is to give parents a choice of where to send their schools, and it worked in Milwaukee with a voucher system where they allowed parents to pick if you want your children to go to a public school, a Catholic school, or a charter school. And Milwaukee had a worse graduation rate than we did, and over a four-year time period, their graduation rate increased to the 70% level. I don't know where it is as of this year. You know, I'm sure they're gonna have studies out about it, but it's not a mock on the Buffalo Public School systems. I'm a product, actually, of the Buffalo Public Schools, having gone to PS 81 and having gone to McKinley High School as well. But it's just that I don't know what's changed. Something changed since I went there. Something happened. I didn't cause it when I was there, but something happened where it just, there's a lot of fear in people. You see it in the papers even today. There's a lot of bickering going on between the parents' council, the superintendent, the unions, about, you know, race to the top money, that the federal government is mandating that we have certain things here or else you're not getting the money, and just nobody's getting on the same page. And it's, and the ones that are hurting are the students, and I'm glad that Governor Cuomo sent him a State of the State address this year that and this is true, and it was kind of funny. He said the principals have lobbyists, the teachers have lobbyists, the janitor has lobbyists, the bus drivers have lobbyists. He goes, well, the students don't have a lobbyist. So he showed a picture of his office door on the State of the State address, and underneath said Governor Cuomo, lobbyist for the students. And I thought that was the best thing ever that I've seen, and that's something that he's putting forward by trying to implement this teacher evaluation system to get this race at the top money. And I'm not, you know, apologizing for it, but we just gave $800 million, an increase of 4% from last year to the public school systems, focusing on need-based districts. And I just hope it works, but it's just, you know, I'm not sure what the answer is. It's collaboration of a lot of things. But when you hear that some of the kindergartens to third grade are missing 7 weeks of school, and then when you go from fourth grade to sixth grade, it goes from 7 to 10 weeks of being missed, 10 weeks of school. And you can't blame the teachers for that, whether you're in charter, Catholic, or public, because kindergarten to third grade, I mean, you know, they're saying, well, you're not interesting the kids. Well, with kindergarten, if you're not going, how do you have the opportunity to have a kid interested? I mean, I remember in kindergarten, what do? We colored and ate the paste, right? it was like a day camp. I mean, I thought it was fun, but, you know, the kids just aren't, there's a disconnect there, and it's not meant to mock the public schools. I like the fact that the graduation rate is a little bit better, but there's a lot of variables there. There's, you know, whether they take disadvantaged kids, whether they don't take them. So there's a lot of things. I just think that I'm a proponent in the sense that if those schools are working, don't shut them down or don't mock them. And I think the Buffalo School Board doesn't like charter schools, and I think they do a fine job. So that's why I say I'm a proponent. I don't want them to get knocked down, just like I don't want like a Buffalo public school to get knocked down. So, yes?
Going to schools, first, thank you for coming here today. Also, you know, many students, and I think the media doesn't recognize how involved you've been with UB 2020 and our institution.
You gotta put that on your website for me.
Is that right?
Nobody understands what that is.
Yeah. Okay. Well, can you briefly explain to the students today in the administration about UB 2020?
Yeah, it was before I came into the Senate, and the reasons why I ran basically are because Western New York was forgotten about. You know, we had the same people in office. They were nothing but people that they were career politicians. They never held a private sector job in their life. They were just basically giving them everything. And I ran on a platform that, you know, we need to have strong representation in Western New York. And myself being an attorney, let me tell you something. I've gone up against some pretty tough, I do a lot of criminal trials. I've gone up against some pretty, pretty stout, you know, cases I won and lost. Attorneys, on both cases, both personal injury and a criminal defense. And when you have something that's like that, to argue with some of these people that are in the Senate and the Assembly is literally a joke, because they can't hold a candle to some of the people that we have here that you fight with every day. And when you see these things, and getting back to your question, when you see these things, what happened was, were you guys here when, if you were a freshman, you probably were, when the tuition went up by $620? Mm-hmm. Were you here? And it was right after you filled out your FAFSA, your TAP, and your PEL, and you're like, okay, now we're going to get $620. Unfortunately, that $620, only $30 of that $620 stayed with the school. The other $590 went into the general fund of the New York State, and they used it somewhere else. In other words, they swept the money. In all SUNY schools, they took all that money that you paid for your tuition, and they swept it. They did the same thing with the Power Project. This is in 2009 and 2010. They did the same thing with the Power Authority along the water, the hydropower plant. Our money, because that's the only one that makes any money there, $550 million, they swept it. When you put a tire on your car, there's the $2.50 you pay for the recycling fee for the tire. There was a fund for that to help companies design better pavement, you know, things along those lines. They swept that money as well. So when you see things like that, and you see that you have students, because I have kids that are in their 20s, and you have students that are saying, you know, I don't have a class that I can graduate now. I got to wait 4.5 years. I thought I was going to be out for 4 years. This is a problem for me. Or, you know what, my class is full. Or, you know what, I don't have a teacher for this class. I don't have this. What UB 2020 to me does, in my opinion, is that for the next 5 years, you know what the tuition is going to be, and if your parents know, the students know what the tuition is going to be. The money stays with the school. It can't be swept, okay? And the money is going to be used, like Buffalo for UB 2020, it was supposed to be UB 2020, but it morphed in a New York SUNY 2020. So the pilot project that I was fighting for in my legislation went statewide. Albany, Binghamton, Stony Brook, and University of Buffalo became what's known as research institutes. They could charge an extra $75 in a registration fee, and they could also charge more money for out-of-state students that are coming here, which after a year, they're just going to become in-state residents anyways, get their degree, and they're going to leave New York State anyways, but that's a different story. But the thing is that the money gets to stay here. And what we wanted to do, not only is the project supposed to be, it was supposed to be bigger than what it was in the North Campus and the South Campus, but because of economic constraints, it's focusing right now on moving the medical campus into the Buffalo Niagara Medical Corridor on that end. But there's also projects that are going on in the North and South Campus that are used for that money. But the important thing to us is this. We had to make sure that public education was still affordable for students that they needed it. So there's still the TAP and their PEL. There's in-state scholarship money that's earmarked from some of the tuition increases to go to an in-state scholarship fund for need-based students. So the ability to still attend this fine institution is still there. But the ability for this institution to keep class sizes, as low as possible, to keep some of your best and brightest professors on board rather than losing them somewhere else, and the ability for students to graduate in 4 years rather than having to take a class that they don't offer in the spring and you gotta wait till the fall or vice versa. Those things are hopefully for the next 5 years are gonna be not happening where you have that ability. So it helps out Buff State as well. Buff State now with that projected is able to complete their science building that they have so they can attract students in their own right at Buff State if you're going through their campus. They're doing some expanding as well. So we have a fine institution here at the University of Buffalo that employs thousands, that has graduated, hundreds of thousands in all different fields. And to have that expansion in North and South Campus and to have them grow and be a part of one of their fine institutions, the medical campus, in the Buffalo Niagara Medical Corridor, which to me is like the new Bethlehem Steel, is tremendous. And that's basically what UB 2020 was, and then it morphed into SUNY 2020, and that's what it is.
You mentioned the solar job.
Excuse me, there's other things too, like there's a free up, because you say, well, how does that money? There's a free up of allowing the university itself on contracts so they don't have to get state approval. And then by the time they get state approval, what they were going to buy is now an increased cost. So, in other words, when you delay on something in construction and you can get it at today's market, well, tomorrow it may be higher. So some of these delays were like 8 months. So something you were getting at this level, now down here is here, but now your budget's all thrown up. So it allows them the flexibility also to do public-private partnerships on bidding and also on collaboration. So for purchasing goods, services, pencils, whatever, copy machines, they don't have to go through those rigorous processes. So we freed up some of the regulation as well.
I'm sorry.
And no,
you mentioned these solar jobs.
Yes.
Can that legislation be used to create solar manufacturing jobs with the existing manufacturing infrastructure that we have here in Buffalo?
Yes.
Or is it primarily for the kind of installation and construction jobs that we saw with the solar strand project?
No. As a matter of fact, that's a good question. As a matter of fact, and I'll read to you what the justification is on this bill. Legislation creates a solar renewable energy credit program which is designed to stimulate the installation and generation of solar energy in New York State. A renewable energy credit model provides investment stability through long-term contracts and competitive bidding in open auctions. Even more importantly, this bill will incentivize the creation of jobs and the growth of new industry in New York. The success of the solar program in New Jersey, because that's where it's modeled from, is documented that this process can work effectively. This bill will also serve through its Buy American and its New York Components Center to stimulate solar manufacturing and production in New York State and the U.S., all while reducing our dependency on foreign sources of fuel and creating over 2,000 megawatts of green energy. So, you know, unfortunately, you know, when I first came to the Senate, I met with representatives from GE that actually wanted to build a manufacturing, and too bad, you know, they didn't approach this year because there's $1 billion for Buffalo through the public-private partnership that the governor has. But unfortunately, they went somewhere else. But there are other facilities that some minority women-based enterprises, who I talked to in Albany, that have money, that are going through a federal process right now to start a business where they're manufacturing. Now, DuPont and another company in Niagara Falls actually make different components of the solar shield, the reflective shield. They actually make two different components. And that's a great start, because if you can get other manufacturing companies to come in and have like a mini cluster, you can produce these and not only then sell them in New York State, creating jobs that way and creating industry, but you can also then sell your product then throughout the United States and throughout the world. So the capability is there. There's a resource center on Fillmore Avenue, I know the gentleman well, that has the capability of training individuals, especially minority women to in training them in the construction and how to put up solar panels. And there's more of those companies. Canisius College has a program, you know, I'm not dishing you beer or anything, just thought I'd get that bigger. They have a program. And, you know, there are other things that can help. But that was a fantastic thing that was there today. And I don't know if any of you were there today, you know, if you were, but it was a fantastic thing to see at that project and how not only is it producing renewable energy, but it's also, they were protecting the landscape as well and the design that was voted on. So it was interesting.
Earlier you were talking about the charter schools, and I want to know your opinion on using schools as community hubs, because I think...
I'm sorry, say that again?
I want to know your opinion on using schools as community hubs. I know, like you were talking about earlier, that a lot of children are not present in schools, but...
Right.
I think that problem is because the system that is in place presumes that these kids have access to adequate housing, food, family life, et cetera, when a lot of times these rare factors keep them from coming to school regularly. And with the Harlem Children's Zone in Harlem, that's shown that a lot of times kids can actually have a higher graduation rate if they do have a school that acts as a community that addresses a lot of these problems in their personal life as well as their academic problems. So I'm gonna know your opinion on that, and also moving away from more standardized tests to more of a holistic type education.
Yeah, I think actually the testing that's done, I think that the Board of Regents is out of touch, and there's something that has to be done there. Are you talking about like having a community-based school, like in the community, rather than having busing?
Yes, because I know Westminster in Buffalo, they
right.
just actually got awarded a
right.
grant from the federal government
right.
for a community-based school.
You know, I'll tell you, I haven't seen that project in Harlem, but I'll tell you what, I would like to see that, and I know that a lot of the persistently low-achieving schools are schools that are in communities, but you have a lot of students are coming from outside of the communities that have to be bused there, and there's a lot of drag with regards to that. But, you know, you got to be careful, because then, you know, then you're talking about going backward. You're almost talking about going backward in a sense of, you know, where you know, if you only have bus and you have community schools, you know, the schools were set up, you know, for segregation, desegregation purposes, and you don't want to have a situation where, you know, everybody's like just staying in their own community doing what they want. But I would be interested in seeing that study, and I can give you my chief of staff's card, and if you could tell me where to find that study, I'd be interested in looking at that. And you make, you know what, you're smart because you make a good point. It isn't just about the kids not getting to the school. It's about the environment that they're living in. You know, their mother or their father, or if they're a single family household, are probably gone way before the child or somebody's there, you know, to even get to school, or maybe a babysitter or an older brother or somebody has to get them there. And there may not be food there, it may not be breakfast. But you gotta take advantage of what is in the schools now. The schools do have their breakfast programs, they do have their lunch programs, but they're not doing enough as far as enticing the people to get to school. And I remember when I went to school, that some of these schools, if you're talking about what I think are in Harlem, some of these schools were open after school. They were open later, they were open into the evening. They became community centers where you could play basketball, where you could do your homework, where they had people that would tutor you. They had things like that. They just don't have them anymore. And back then, when I went, these people were volunteer. They weren't getting paid for it. We just don't have a lot of those volunteers anymore that are willing to do what needs to be done in order to make sure that the kids have the same opportunity, the same passion, the same drive as what led you to be where you are. So, you know, I'd be interested in getting that information from you and moving forward from there.
Two more.
I don't go to the law school, but I'm the president of the Graduate Planning Student Association, School of Architecture and Planning.
Hey, we're not following for that. It's okay.
I'm sorry. I just since you're here.
They did a nice job though. The architect system was involved in that, right? In the design of the solar strand.
Probably. I do urban planning though, so I'm not totally with the architects and
okay.
Everything. More public policy stuff. So my question was about the Empire Development Zones. Because we're an environmental thing, you know, one of the things we talk about at urban planning is that sort of balance between the economy, the environment, and social equity, and how you have to kind of try to balance those. So since we're here for the environment, I was wondering maybe you could share some of your thoughts about how those things play together and how doing work for the environment can help the other two.
The Empire Development Zones right now are they're going to start becoming obsolete because what it was basically a lot of money going to projects that wasn't producing any income or wasn't producing any jobs.
I'm talking about Governor Cuomo's regional economic development.
Oh, okay.
That's
all right, you said Empire. Okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Regionally, that's what took over the Empire.
Yeah.
Development. So it's okay. You know, he has a great chairman. One of them is Satish Chakravarti. President Chakravarti is the chairman, along with Howard Zemsky, who was a smart and fine individual in his own right with regard to some of the projects he's done in the Larkin District and everything else, are the co-chairs of this particular committee. And you have mayors and other citizens that are on this board that range from Youngstown to Jamestown, from just west of Rochester to Buffalo. And what it is, it's a pool of funds that government puts up, and you actually have to show why you should get this money, okay? What jobs are gonna be created from these projects? Whereas before, you would just have to say, oh yeah, I'm gonna expand here and I'm gonna have like, you know, maybe 100 jobs. Well, they'd give you all this money and you get like two jobs out of it. So it wasn't working, and we were spending a lot of money. And trust me, the money didn't come up here all that often. Anyways, to Western New York, which is why I was glad that it was gone. But the regional councils, there's 10 of them that are across the state. And this particular one that Chakravarti and Zemsky have, it goes from western part of Rochester to Buffalo, north and south. And the money that's there, Buffalo won, the Western New York Regional Council, I said, won the largest prize last year, $100 million, for 98 projects. Now, I do have a list of what those projects are. And you know, through my chief of staff. Actually, I think my wife knows them all on the top of your head, don't you? Okay, so you can talk to her. You can talk to her after. But what's good about it is this: number one, you cut out the red tape of having to go to Albany to try to get the money. Number two, you have leaders in your community now that are on this board and are on this committee that actually know what these projects are and they know what it's going to generate and they know if it's going to work in your community. So it's kind of like a process where, you know, you present your plan, and if your plan is something that's going to generate jobs and it's going to have an economic boost to a specific region or what have you, then you're going to have success. So We just, in this last budget, put the monies up for the second round of funding. And, you know, I'm proud, and I think that we can do well again and get another second round. But 98 projects, and I think it's going to be, you know, hundreds of jobs that are basically available for that, if not more. That's what's important. But there's two others that are there, and I'll just touch on these real quick. Remember how I was telling you that 2009, 2010, there was $550 million swept from the Power Authority? Okay. When the Power Authority was set up, they were very instrumental in the manufacturing component of Western New York. They would basically entice manufacturing companies to come in. They would offer them megawatts of power. I'll give you an example. They would say, we'll give you 5 megawatts of power at a reduced rate or what have you to come here. And a big manufacturing company would say, that's great, saves me a lot of money, I'm in, I'm there. Well, as the manufacturing started to decline, these companies didn't need 5 megawatts of power. Let's say they only needed 3. Well, the other 2 that was there and was available is now being sold on the open market. What was happening in the past is they were having a sale of this unused power, and it's a lot of it, trust me. Sale of this unused power from this power plant, and the money was going downstate. So our power plant money for sale of the unused power is going downstate. Does that surprise you? None of our leaders fought for that. My first year, we passed legislation that protected it. In this budget this year, we have the power proceeds bill for Western New York. What it is that any sale of the unused power in this region, any sale of the unused power, cannot be go anywhere except within a 30-mile radius of the power plant, which includes Niagara and Erie counties. Okay, and what it's used for is for, again, there's a commission board where they go ahead and they say, submit your plan. It's another avenue than the regional council. If you want to purchase equipment, need some help, you can write to them. You want to expand your business because you want to hire more employees, you can write to them. Some of the things that it can't be used for is expansion on sports stadiums, some other public facilities, things along those lines. It's another job creating pool of money, and right now there's $14 million of it, it'll grow, that is utilized now for Western New York. So that's huge. Rather than having that money being swept, now it can't be swept, or sold on the open market, now it basically it stays here. So that's another way. So you have those two now, the regional council and that. The other thing that we have is the billion for Buffalo. That started with $100 million right now. It's $75 million in capital money. There's $25 million in some other tax incentives. What that is for, it's different than the regional council. It's different than the power proceeds allocation. It is literally a pot of money that and they've hired somebody from Washington. I can't think of his name off the top of my head, but he's world-renowned of finding industry worldwide to come to an area. And I've talked to people like Toyota and a few others. You know, Toyota maybe having a parts manufacturing plant over on Vulcan. It's on a lot of streets over there because there's a lot of vacant GM buildings that they can be used. Talks to a lot of companies. What it's looking for is one big manufacturer or a cluster of businesses that focus on one particular piece of manufacturing. Nanodynamics was done in Albany, but it's something that's what they're looking for. And we'll see if it's a success, but the money's on the table. You know, it's a short window, but it's something that we're hoping that could also be an economic boost. And you know, it doesn't seem like it, but the job growth in Buffalo actually is starting to increase. There was over 5,700 jobs put on last month than there were a year ago. In addition, so our unemployment rate is actually going a little bit lower, and we're being recognized. You know, this past year, Governor Cuomo has been here a lot, and it's not. You know, we have a good relationship, me and him, and it's not by, you know, coincidence. He understands that Western New York has been forgotten about far too long, and he knows that we're all one New York State. Downstate doesn't feel like that. We may not feel like that to downstate, but he gets it, and he says if this region fails, downstate's going to fail. So we need to get some help there. And there's a lot of things with the state taking over Medicaid, get rid of farm abuse. There's a lot of things that are there. So, Charlie, I don't know if they're going to let me ask me a question on hydrofracking.
It's actually 7:20.
You know what? I'm standing here with a crystal ball of the future in my hands. May I share it with you?
Yes.
A lot of people know that I famously called you 3 days before the election and talked about hydrofracture. When I did that, I had 4 years of unconventional exploration history in my pocket, in my background. I've stayed on the issue for the last 2 years as if I was on a staff, unpaid, researching it. I want very badly for it to be safe and successful. I wish to high hell we could drill these wells and have everything be okay. Problem is, even if we could do it, the methane, that we're releasing in the atmosphere will be catastrophic. The crystal ball, I know everyone's restless, I'll make it short. The crystal ball I'm holding for you is that without any pay, I've risen to the top epicenter of the brightest and best voices across the state. I'm not a name dropper. I welcome any of you to see my emails. They're very upset with you. And my concern is that I've always come up, I've always stood, I love that you're a fighter, I love that you love your wife. I need you to fight on this. It's 1,000 times more important than marriage equality. And I'm telling you that we're not going to get the primary one politically if we don't stand stronger. It is the loopholes in all the legislation. I was here a year ago to talk about the severe loopholes in the water withdrawal legislation. I was right back then. Lo and behold, all the best minds have upheld that I was right since then. And our own DEC does not intend to enforce your legislation across the next 5 years. If hydrofracture comes to play, that will be a comprehensive disaster. It is all the loopholes in Mr. Erdman's legislation that are the problem.
What's the question?
The question is, what are you going to do harder on this, more devoted on this? It is your legacy moment, and it is an item that sets the future of this state either horribly backward for water and air impact or forward for renewable.
Right.
And I like you. I wouldn't be here all these times.
I see it every event that I'm in, and I appreciate it. He is a hard worker. And he doesn't
I've taken
like
so much heat defending you to my crunchiest peers. But what I have to tell you is that, Mr. Northrop, go home and read the Art Voice. I am the balancing entity between Mr. Northrop and Mr. Quigley in a post that was released about 4 hours ago. Read it. Mr. Northrop, who was in your office to discuss home rule, very, very upset with you. Ms. Slajay, very, very upset with you. Mr. Galay, not too happy. On and on and on. You need to get stronger. You need to get harder. I would show up with your arm around Mr. Othello on Wednesday and get devoted.
I don't know if you got here late, but as I said in my press conference when I released the five bills, there is a moratorium right now on hydraulic fracturing. There is no money in the budget for it. There is nothing happening with regards to it. There's an SGIS report that's coming out that's going to decide. My five bills, I wanted to put into the mix. And I don't know who the people are going to like me, but the top four environmental groups, organizations in this state, the top four in the state, backed my legislation. If they didn't like it, they would have backed it. So I understand who's there from our voice and everybody else.
I'm going home to my autistic little boy. With respect, there is no substitution for a fully transparent, fully engaged health impact assessment. Judith Ank, DEC regional captain, just called for it on Friday. Please look at it. Please address it. No substitution for something done behind closed doors, half funded, looking at the very core of a health impact assessment is we get it on the table, it's transparent.
Charlie, you know I always keep my options open and I look on both issues. And I appreciate you as always. Thank you very much. You owe me $10.
Yeah, we've been a friendly battle, of course.
Yeah.
No, he is somebody who's passionate and has a concern. And as I said, I mean, with regards to high volume hydraulic fracturing, it's not happening right now. So you have to wait and see. And you know, you don't need to jump the gun on something that's not happening. You see what's happening. But he's passionate, and you know what? If somebody's passionate about that, I don't know if it's 1,000 times more important than he was talking about in marriage equality, because they're two separate and distinct issues altogether. And when one gentleman was talking about the charter schools or hydrofrack, and I didn't get that either. But they're separate issues, and you have to treat it as such. And as I said before, you know, if you don't do the research on issues and you don't look at both sides of a problem, whether it's in school, whether it's in life, whether it's in anything, you're never going to be satisfied with your decision on what you do, and that's why you just got to, that's how I approach things, by looking at both sides of the issues. I never skirt anybody, so. All right? I appreciate the time here tonight. Thank you very much.